Echo? No.
Do you want it?
No.
All right.
Good evening.
Good evening.
It seems like it's been forever since we met, and
it has been that long since I've done a lesson.
It has. Uh oh. Don't tell on yourself.
I'm an honest person.
2 weeks ago, Chris. It was 2 weeks ago, Chris. Well, last week we had business meeting. So 2 weeks ago, Chris did the lesson, and I'm so thankful for that. We got great feedback. And then last week we did have our business meeting, and they are actually up and running and working in the basement. And there has been a ton done already. If you do have some extra time, get with Bill Johnson, Sherry Wood when she gets back, Rich Woods, Floyd Norris, Andrea Hott, get with them and ask when they're going to be working, because there is a lot to do. And even if you don't, even if you are not very handy, there's still a lot to do down there. And so, but we've got, and Chuck, there's another one, Chuck Horvath. They've got a great start. I'm really excited about what's going to happen, and we're excited about the kids that we're going to be able to minister to. So, great stuff. So good to be back with you, and we will have, even though next week is camp meeting, we're still going to have a Wednesday night service. And we'll be covering the last of the third section, which is just so hard to believe. It just seems to go so quick. Goes so quick when I teach this. But so we'll be doing that. Many of you have asked about Eden, and just to kind of give you an update on her. She's doing better. She, of course, she's not in the hospital anymore, and they still don't have any clue what's going on. And she's able to eat a little bit, but not a lot. But she's doing better, but she's still, I mean, she looks as pale as a piece of paper and has lost a lot of weight. So keep praying for her, and we'll see what God has in store. But she's home, and she's doing a little bit better, so we know God's going to take care of it. So, all right, and remember also in prayer, we'll go to prayer in just a second. Remember Pastor Seabright, he is up at Wellsburg Church of God, and his mother passed away. And is there a thunder?
No, that's your microphone, but I don't know why.
I'm speaking with authority. Thunder. It thunders when you speak. Wow. Jim Seabright's, Pastor Jim Seabright's mother passed away, and the viewing's today, and was today, and the service will be tomorrow. So be praying for that. I'll be driving up to Wellsburg to go to the funeral to honor him and her life. So, all right. Well,
Dwayne
go.
Clark.
What's that?
Dwayne Clark,
yes. We have not heard anything on Dwayne Clark. Last report we got was that he was having a heart cath, and we have not heard anything from that. So
she did say he had a heart attack.
Yeah. It said that they thought that he was having a heart attack.
We're not sure. Yeah, the last report we received was they think he did. It's not been confirmed. So
might be your beard.
Had it on Facebook that he
no.
Did.
Yeah, that's what I
did.
Read.
She have it on Facebook? Okay.
Yeah, that he did have.
Is he still in the hospital?
Yeah, they're keeping it.
Okay, they were supposed to do it today, but they didn't do it today?
That's the last thing she put on there.
This is starting to annoy me. How about you, buddy? Let's unplug your mic and plug it back
in.
Is your battery level showing good? It's on
sure.
The little screen on the front, little bar graph.
3-2.
Little bar graph. Shows your battery level.
You're the technology person.
Shows good.
All right. Yes, ma'am.
Linda said that Dwayne did have a heart attack last night, and his cath is canceled for today, and we'll have it on Thursday now.
Okay. So let's be praying for Dwayne and see what's going on. So, all right. Well, why don't you join me in word of prayer, please? Father, thank you for this time and this day. You are so good to us. We love you. I thank you for each person that's here, Lord. Thank you for the men that prepared a meal for us. And Lord, you just take care of us in so many ways. And Lord, we just ask that you're with Dwayne right now. We ask, Lord, that you'll touch his body. We ask, Lord, that you will just strengthen him. And we pray that no damage has taken place to his heart. We ask, Lord, that he'll heal up and this heart cap will show exactly what needs to happen. And Lord, we bring Eden to you, and we're going to keep praying for her as we're not sure what's going on, but you know. And so we're just trusting in you, we're counting on you and looking to you, and you're going to take care of us. You always do, you always have, you always will, because you're God. And so I thank you for my brothers and sisters. I thank you for what you're doing. Thank you, Father, for the exciting next phase of ministry with the children that's going on. And I just ask, Lord, that all the work will get done. There's a lot of work, but it'll get done in your time. And it's going to be a way to honor you and glorify you. So thank you for all that you're doing. And we come before you in Jesus' name. Amen. All right. Now, I know it has been forever, but we are going to recite the books of the Bible from Genesis to Romans. Ready?
Let's go slow.
Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus,
Numbers, Deuteronomy, Joshua, Judges, Ruth, 2 Samuel,
1 Kings,
2 Kings,
1 Chronicles, 2 Chronicles,
Ezra,
Nehemiah, Esther,
Job,
Psalms, Proverbs, Ecclesiastes,
Song of Solomon,
Isaiah,
Jeremiah,
Lamentations,
Ezekiel,
Daniel,
Hosea,
Joel,
Amos,
Obadiah,
Jonah,
Micah, Nahum, Habakkuk, Zephaniah, Haggai,
Malachi, Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, Acts,
Romans.
Look at that. Fantastic. You all are doing so good. It is incredible. And we did look at Deuteronomy 32:30. And so anyone remember Deuteronomy 32:30? I encourage you to memorize at least the address of this verse because it's very powerful. Deuteronomy 32:30. Let's say that together. How could one man, did you not memorize this one? Oh, we did? Okay. How could one man chase 1,000 or two put 10,000 to flight unless the rock had sold them, unless the Lord had given them up? And what I want to encourage you with Deuteronomy 32:30, what I really want to strongly encourage you is that what that verse is the verse is actually kind of taunting the enemies of God. And it's saying that, you know what, your God says you're so strong, but our God is so big that even if you put 1,000 or 10,000 against us, you can't do it. And so their Lord has sold them out, but our God is faithful. And so that's a powerful verse because have you ever noticed in life that you don't just have one problem? Has anybody ever noticed that before? Does anybody in here just have one problem? All right, if you say that, you have two problems. Your second problem is lying. Every one of us has more than one problem. And sometimes it seems when we have two or three problems, it seems that it just kind of can grow and can keep going and things like that. And so that's why Deuteronomy 32:30 is so powerful. As I remember that is, you know what? They can come against me in thousands or tens of thousands, but our God has not given us up. Our God is there. So, all right, well, and yes, ma'am. No, tonight is the priorities of the servant.
Okay. How come I'm getting ahead and I already memorized
it? You're a wizard.
Yeah? Did you go to the next one?
I don't think so.
Chris, are you just ahead of us?
I should be. That would have been last.
The attitude of a servant was last
year. Yeah, that would have been 2 weeks ago.
That was the one you taught with the Galatians.
Yep. You taught attitude of a servant.
Yes, yes.
That was 2 times. That was 3 times. 3 weeks ago. 2 lessons ago.
All right. So what page are we on?
We are on priorities of a servant.
533.
533 and
530
says
Galatians. Wait a second. So it's 554. Priorities of a servant. Oh, day 4. No, it's day 4.
Day 5.
That's from last week. So did I do Deuteronomy 32:30? Did I go back to?
Yes.
Okay. So it's my mistake. It's not your mistake. That's why you all were looking at me like, so what was last week's verse? Galatians 5:22-23?
Yes.
The fruit of the Spirit? Okay, so let's say that one. The fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Excellent. All right. Well, thank you for being patient with me as I got the verses mixed up. All right.
No more breaks.
When you do a break, it's tough to get back to and tough to figure yourself. Well, this lesson tonight, Priorities of a Servant, this actually is very incredible. And this one can be life-changing. And I'm not saying that glibly, because a lot of times what happens with people, what happens with us, is we kind of just coast. We get busy, we kind of do this and that, and before we know it, it's another year's gone by. And it's so easy for time to fly so quickly. I mean, we're at the end of July already. It's incredible. And so one very important thing that we have to do as servants is we have to prioritize. And so this whole week, we're going to be looking at kind of priorities and goals, and we're going to be looking, taking a deep, hard look at where we're at as people. So let's jump into day one. First of all, we all have bank accounts. And the bank accounts don't contain silver, gold, or cash, or currency. These banks possess an item that's much more valuable. We're all allotted a bank of time. Time is our most precious commodity. If we lost all our money, we could work hard enough to build back reserve. If we lost all of our relationships, eventually we would form new ones. But when time passes, it can't be retrieved. Once time is gone, it's spent. I mean, it's it. Time favors no person. Every one of us has the same amount of time. We all have 168 hours a week. And in that week, there's 10,080 minutes, and that's 604,800 seconds. And we all have the same amount, from the king to the peasant, from the pauper to the prince, from the billionaire to the one who's destitute. We all have the same amount. But one of the rationalizations that we as people do is we say, well, we can't grow closer to God, or we can't get involved, or we can't do this because we don't have what?
Time.
We don't have time. But everybody else, we all have the same time. And so this week we're going to examine some facts and biblical truths and ways that our time can be used to glorify God. You know, you can get so busy doing God work that you can miss out on God. You can get so busy doing good things, you can miss out on God. And so we're going to look at this factor of time. We all have the same amount of time. There's a specific time when each one will face, and that's the time of our death. Well, this is kind of encouraging. We're all going to die. That's a fact. Unless the Lord returns our lifetimes. We're all going to pass away one day from this life as we know it. And so this is what we need to know. Every one of us is going to pass away into eternity. It always amazes me that as Christians, I'm not saying this glibly, but as Christians, we get so worked up about dying. Folks, we're all going to die. You know, when I got hit in the car accident, as I remember, as I was being pushed into the embankment and the median, the only thing that went, you know, they say, well, your life passes through your mind. My life didn't. The only thing I thought of, I said, isn't this wild? I'm going to die falling off into a river. That's the only thing. I said, Lord, I just don't want to die that way. I don't know how I want to die. I just didn't want to die that way. I wasn't afraid of dying. I just was like, Lord, really? Is this how I'm going to go? And you know, Janine was like, what were you praying? I was like, you don't want to know.
You have a lot of faith in our bridge.
Yeah. I did have faith in your bridge. But that was the only thing that was going through my mind was, you know, and so someone said, what, were you scared? No. And I was okay. I mean, I don't want to get on the bus to go to be the Lord tonight, but you know what? If it happens, I will. But it amazes every one of us is going to cross over to eternity, unless, of course, the Lord returns. Hebrews 9:27, just as people are destined to die once and after that to face judgment. And so that's what we as Christians, we need to know, is we do not fear death, because death is graduation. Death is the crossing over into eternity, into where we're going to go into the presence of Jesus. Now, there's a time for everything, and there's also a proper time. We as people tend to want things done when?
Now.
Now, God knows not only the right time, but God knows the perfect time. Now, we always think we know the right time, don't we? But God knows the perfect time. And there's been seasons in lives of most people when we've not understood the timing of God, but there will be a day when we comprehend all things. And God has a specific time for everything. Ecclesiastes 3:17. I said to myself, God will bring in a judgment, both the righteous and the wicked, for there's a time for every activity, a time to judge every deed. So there is a time for everything. And if we are not waiting on God's time and we want to get done in our time, it may not be the right time. If it's not the right time, then it's not the right thing. There are several scriptures to instruct us how quickly time passes. There's a saying that time waits for no man. And time is precious. Once it slips away, it's gone. Never comes back. We're to be faithful stewards of the time that God's allowed us to have. I like this. The Israelites had weaved clothing back and forth using a weaver's shuttle. And this was a piece of wood that held yarn, and it was passed back and forth to weave the piece of yarn, and they would have done that by hand because a machine wasn't invented until 1733 by John Kay. So as they were weaving this, they would really imagine this verse. So our time goes quickly. In Job 7:6, my days are swifter than a weaver's shuttle, and they come to end without hope. And so remember, they're passing the weaver shuttle back and forth, and so quickly they're seeing the yarn unwind. And that's kind of how what Job is saying is, man, my life is quicker than this. It's just going on. It really is amazing. This last weekend, I had pastored the Main Street Church of God in 1996. And that church is a very unique history. It has 100 years. It's 100 years old, and they've only had 4 pastors. And what happened is George Skinner pastored for 40 years, then he passed it to his son, Glenn Skinner. And then they got a young, upstart hotshot who thought he could follow 80 years of one family, and God blessed that crazy young guy named C.J. Plogger, and God did incredible things. And so I was there for a little over 5 years. Then the next pastor, Don Billy, he stayed there for 15 years. So all 3 living pastors of a 100-year church were there at the thing last week. And it was incredible that we planted a tree, and Pastor Glenn, who's in his late 80s, he shoveled the first one, and I shoveled the second one, and Pastor Don did the third one. That's so cool. But it's so funny. I was there 16 years ago, and some people I walked, as soon as I saw them, I knew exactly who they were. I mean, they have not changed in 16 years. They have not changed at all. Not gained a pound. They have the same hair or lack of hair. They were the same. Some people I looked at and I said, I don't know who they are. And they came to me, Pastor CJ. I'm thinking, hi. And then it went, boom. And then some of them said, who are you? And I said, I'm Pastor CJ. And I said, no, you're not. He was a young, thin guy with black hair. And I said, yeah, here I am. So, you know, and it just amazed me. This last weekend was so neat because in some ways, I walked through the parking lot. That's where Jonathan taught him how to ride his bike. Eden was born. I drove through the hospital hospital parking lot where Eden was born, and I could tell you exactly where Anna. We had a preschool at the church, and I could tell you exactly where Anna snuck in. She was a year younger than preschool, but she snuck in. She sat down with a backpack, and so when the teachers took their class, they took Anna. I couldn't find Anna, and I'm looking around, and she's sitting in a preschool class, and the teacher took her half a day to realize this kid shouldn't be there. And so I'm walking through there, and it's almost like those memories are just walking with me. It was so beautiful. But then all of a sudden, you know, they said, Pastor, do you remember when we built a softball field and you played third base? And I was like, yeah, it was a long time ago. I'm reminded I'm not the third baseman I was years ago, and I'm not any softball player. Janine has forbid me to play softball now. And so it's amazing how quick time goes. It is true. It's amazing how quick time goes. And so cherish that. Cherish that. So remember Job, is our days are just like the weaver's shuttle. Time in our life has been described as now you see it, now you don't. While we were once visible, we eventually shrank from the eyesight of those around and slowly faded into a bygone memory. When we realize how quick time passes, it helps us understand it's not about making a big one-time impact, but it's about a series of smaller ones. You know, it's not the home runs that win baseball games. It's the singles. It's the little stuff. You know, we all want to do something fantastic, all something big. Oh, if we could just have something written in the sky. No, it's the little things. It's the little day-by-day things. And when we do those, that's what's important. So time slowly dissipates until it's no more. James 4:14. Why, you don't even know what will happen tomorrow. What is your life? You're like a mist that appears for a little while and then vanishes. And when you think of the imagery of a mist, boy, it can cloud up, it's very visible, and then what happens? It just kind of slowly just kind of goes away. Well, as times of our lives go on, there's going to be seasons when we're afraid. There's moments when fear ripples through our heart and we can be seized with terror. And in many of those cases, they are unfounded fears. And when we look back at some of our worries and concerns, they really didn't amount to anything. Now, don't answer this out loud, but has there ever been anything you've worried about and it didn't come true? Has there ever been anything you were worked up about and you look back on it and it never happened? And this is, how many times have we had loved ones when they're 15 minutes late from coming home, we have them dead on the side of the road? And so what we do is we do that so much. And so what happens with our time is if we spend that worrying or if we spend that getting worked up, then we've kind of thrown that time away. Sometimes how people say, well, Pastor, I'm dying. We all are. None of us is guaranteed tomorrow. None of us is guaranteed another breath. And so our time's compared to that as a shadow that lurked large but then pulled back. And Psalms 102:11, it says, my days are like the evening shadow. See how big that is? And then I wither away like grass. And grass kind of slowly just withers away. So our lives have been compared to grass and flowers that once were beautiful and fragrant, and they slowly start fading into a shriveling former state. That which was majestic and blooming kind of dwindles to a lesser form. And that's a natural progression of life. That's what life is. And we grow and grow, and eventually we start to return to the point of our creation. So it's important to know one day we're going to return to the earth. Isaiah 46, the voice says, cry out, and I said, what shall I cry? All people are like grass, and their faithfulness is like the flowers of the field. There'll be a day when we're all back to how we were created. So the whole point of today's study, and you said, boy, this is a really encouraging one. It has a point. The whole point is to know how precious and short time is. You know, when we were younger, time took forever. Christmas seemed to take 5 years to get here, didn't it? You're like, Christmas is never going to get here. Now as we mature, it feels like we just celebrated Christmas last month and it's going to be here before we know it. I mean, it just goes so quick.
Yeah, the tree's already up.
Yeah, it is. Wow. Or maybe you didn't take it down from last year. So it's crucial to be faithful with the time we've been blessed. Colossians 4:5, be wise in the way you act towards outsiders. Make the most of every opportunity. So what I want to encourage is don't take time for granted. Don't be glib about time, because time is precious. Time is the only thing we can't get back. And as we look to what the Bible says, what do we think about it? And this is what I want to ask you. Have we used our time wisely? Are there some changes that we need to make so that God will consider us faithful servants of the time he's given us? Are there some things that we need to say, you know what, this is really not a good stewardship of my time. This is really not honoring God with my time. And ask ourselves those hard questions and really be real about them. Psalms 91:11, I love this. This is Janine's favorite verse. For he'll command his angels concerning you to guard you in all of your ways. And so that's going to be one that we're going to, as we talk about priorities, to guard you in the ways. And then we're going to be writing out the first 51. Whew. Hang on, there's only 66, so we're getting close. We're bumping it. We're almost there. Day two. Now we're going to kind of get into some. Day one is kind of talking about the time, the aspect of time. Days two, three, four, we're and even five, we're going to start to get into some practical, some real applicable stuff. And we're talking today about the day two of the importance of setting priorities. Most of us are busy. Even those who work full-time, they have to balance work, family, church, other commitments. Even those who don't work full-time, as they already put in their time, they keep very busy. I've had a lot of retired people say that they're so busy now, they don't know how they found time to work. And so it seems that we all are busy. Every one of us is busy. And many expect so much of us, and we can get involved in so much, it's easy to get overwhelmed. That's why it's crucial for us to set priorities. A priority is something that is important and special to us. It's an item or items that we consider valuable and we want to guard our time. Our priority could be our time with God, could be our time with our family, but what is our priority? If we don't set priorities, we are going to be pulled in many directions. If we don't set priorities, everyone is going to get a piece of us, and if we think we can give pieces out to everyone, we can't. Many people in our lives have needs and they expect us to take care of their needs. Many people have not set proper priorities in their lives, but they want us to do their priorities. There's a great saying, your improper planning does not necessitate an emergency on my part. and how true that is. I'll have someone call and I'll say, Pastor, I got to talk to you right now. I've got a problem. I say, okay, how long have you had a problem? I've had it for 10 years. Well, then you know what? We can wait till next week. And I'm not trying to belittle it. I'm just saying, if you've got a problem for 10 weeks, we're not going to solve it in the next hour. And so too often what we do is people will suck us dry. They will pull us. They will eat us. They will take us apart a little at a time. And if we don't have priorities, our life will overtake us. And what happens is we're doing everything, but we're doing nothing. The first miracle of Jesus was actually thrust on him. John 2:4, Jesus is hanging out, and he's at the wedding in Cana, and you remember what happens? Everything's going okay, and then all of a sudden they run out of wine, and Mary says he's going to take care of it. And John 2:4, Jesus said, woman. Now that was a term of endearment, Gnai is the Hebrew word. And he said, woman, why do you involve me? My hour has not yet come. You know what Jesus was saying is, slow down, Mom. My priority is just to kind of get going. And Mary was like, fix it. And how I know so many people that want me to fix it or others to fix it instead of themselves.
The interesting thing there is she already knew he could do miracles.
Right. Yes. Yes. Yeah. Yeah. She knew he was the Son of God and she believed him. And that's why she's take care of this.
She must have seen when he was like we know about that gap.
Isn't that great? Isn't that great? Well, Jesus knew what was important. He had his priorities. When we know our priorities and we stick to them, it actually frees us to do what God expects us. If we don't have our priorities outlined, then what's going to happen is we're going to find ourselves overtaken by a flood of requests. Sometimes we're so busy doing the good, we don't do anything great. Sometimes we're so busy doing what we think is the necessary that we're really missing out on what is the most necessary. So many people came to Jesus wanting something from him, but he said, this is why I'm here. Matthew 15:24, I was sent only to the lost sheep of Israel. Jesus very clearly told him, this is my job. This is what I'm here for. So there's times when we have things that need to be accomplished. They're all important. They must be done. But it's at a point where we need to sit down and prioritize our priorities. We need to truly work through which ones are important and in what order must they take place. Sometimes we have the right priorities, but we don't have them in the right order. So priorities have a plan. Proverbs 24:27. Put your outdoor work in order and get your fields ready. After that, build your house. Great advice. Because what happened to you? You got to have a house. You got to have shelter, but you got to get your crops in. What happens if you spend all your time getting your house built? What's not going to happen? You're not going to eat. And so what Proverbs is saying is get your future taken care of and then get your immediate. And so there's always a time for priorities. Jesus taught a parable about a man who had a plan and he thought were important priorities, but he learned a valuable lesson. While we're here on earth, it's crucial to work through our priorities, but always keep in our mind eternal priorities. Our top overarching priority has to be our relationship with God. That has to be it. No matter what's going on in your life, no matter what's happening in your world, the most important thing is where are you at with God? Where are you at with Jesus Christ? As fleeting as passage of time, it's going to be before, we're going to be before God before we know it. Luke 12:20, you remember the man, he wanted to build more barns and more barns, and God said, you fool, this very night your life will be demanded. Then who will get what you prepared? Remember, he kept buying more and selling more and buying more and building bigger barns and building barns, and God said, you're missing the point. There's times we're doing good works. We can even be accomplishing what we feel is important or necessary. It's important we make sure our priorities line up with the priorities God has for us. We can be so busy doing good things, we miss out on something great from God. So let's be careful not to get wrapped up in what we're doing, we miss out on God. Luke 10:41 and 42, of course you know the passage. Martha, Martha, the Lord answered, you're worried and upset about many things, but few things are needed, or indeed only one. Mary has chosen what's better, and it will not be taken from her. Martha was doing good work. Martha was serving. Martha was showing hospitality. Martha was taking care of people. But you know what, Jesus, and Martha's getting mad because Mary's sitting around. And Peter has spilled something again. And we see over there that, you know, John has kicked the table over and everything's going haywire. And Mary is sitting there at Jesus' feet. And Martha says, make her work. And Jesus says, slow down. She's doing what she needs to do. And so sometimes we get so busy working that God will just say, hey, just come here. Just kind of sit at my feet for a little bit. Just kind of hang out. Everything we possess one day will be gone. Oh, thanks a lot, Pastor. Everything you possess will be gone, including you. The only thing that's going to hang around is your soul. Everything else is gone. This right here is a shell. Someday the Grizels or Allmeyers or Frank over at Care, someday he's going to put embalming fluid in this. And you're going to come and say, oh, we really liked him. And then you're going to go back to the church and eat some chicken. It's reality. It's going to happen. And so we need to understand that we don't own this. Our only possession is our relationship with him. And all of our material property, all we have, all we've earned, will either rust, break down, or be no more. And that's why it's so vital to concentrate on eternal priorities. Our eternal priorities will be with us forever. Mark 8:36. What good is it for someone to gain the whole world, yet forfeit what?
Their soul.
So how can we know we're pursuing eternal? How can we know we're truly comprehending when seeking what God wants? We can know how to seek eternal things for us. God clearly outlines for them how we can set and fulfill eternity priorities. God wants us to know what his priorities. Matthew 6:33, but seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be given to you as well. So this week, I'm really going to challenge you this week to ask some really hard questions. What are your top three priorities? What are three things that are God-given, important to you to draw closer to God, that God wants you to have? What are three priorities? Then, what we're going to do is we can see our priorities by how we spend time. How much time are we spending with our top three priorities? Because time equals love. If you say you love someone, you'll spend time with them. And so we need to understand that is, what are we doing with our priorities? Are we achieving our priorities? Well, my priority is come to know the Lord. How much time are we spending with the Lord? My priority is serving the Lord. What exactly are we doing to serve the Lord? And so when we look at the overall scheme, this is going to be a challenging week for some of us. It's a tough week. When I sit down and do this week, and I do it often because I want to kind of do a check on where am I at? What's important to me? And it doesn't matter what you say is important. It's what you do. What you do is your priority. I know a lot of people that say, well, my priority is my family. And so I'll say, well, how much time do you spend with family? Oh, an hour a day. An hour a day, and that's a priority. How much time do you spend watching TV? About an hour and a half a day. And so we have to really look at what our priorities are. And then how are we spending our time? If this is a priority, if knowing God is a priority, what are we doing? How are we getting to know him? How are we spending time with him? So this is going to be a good one. And if we're not spending proper time for our priorities, what do we need to do? It was funny. Janine gave me a real hard time about Facebook because for years I preached how terrible it was. And then about 6 months ago, I got on it. And let me tell you, I'm getting off it very quickly. I know there's a lot of good stuff, but I was finding myself. I was reading and saying, why am I watching this cute kitten video? How much is that drawing me closer to the Lord? And how is this watching this dog crawl through a tunnel and jump up over a car? How is that drawing me closer to God? And so there's some good stuff on Facebook. I'm not preaching against it, but I'm very, very, very now a priority is about every 3 days. That's what I'll do is I'll only look at it for about an hour only every 3 days. Because what happens is it'll suck you in. It'll pull you in. And that's like email, that's like the internet, that's like anything, is what happens is before we know it, isn't it amazing that when we stand in line, every second we know we are, but when we're sitting on our couch with a boob tube, boy, that time just goes like that. And so what is our priority? So making a commitment. So we talked about priorities, we're going to talk about making a commitment. An important component of being a faithful steward with our time that's been entrusted as the priorities we believe are important is to follow through. If we went through, probably every one of us would be able to say, these are my priorities. And that's wonderful. Are we doing something about them? Are our priorities, are we actually following through with them? There's many who mean well but don't make commitments. A commitment is a choice that says this is going to take place no matter what. And if we don't make a commitment to honor God with our time and have healthy priorities, we're not going to accomplish them. We can make all the commitments in the world. And matter of fact, let's be honest, how many times we promise God on a Sunday, Lord, I'm going to read more of your word, and then on Monday we get busy. How many times have we promised God, Lord, I'm going to pray more every day, and then we get tied up? And so commitment is about following through. We've got to prioritize and then make a commitment. So every commitment we make should have a foundational point. It's out of the bedrock that we base all of our commitments. The commitment, first of all, must be to God. We were created to worship and work for God. We were created to be complete through Him by Him being in us. And if we're not committed to God, then we can't truly commit to anything else. Commitment's got to start with God. Psalm 37:5, commit your way to the Lord, trust in Him, and He will do this. A lot of times we want God to do things, especially, you know, it's very interesting, especially when I pray for people who are in the hospital and things, and they'll say, oh, I haven't been at church in 6 months, pray to God for me. I'm thinking, I'm going to pray you start coming to church, you know, and I'm not picking on people, but what I'm saying is that, isn't it interesting, we always run to God when we need something. But we need to first be committed to Him, connected to Him. Being committed to someone or something may not be easy. There's times when filling commitments is difficult. It may take all we are or all the strength we possess. God is so committed to us, He gave His Son. Jesus is so committed to us, He gave up everything. And He became that for us, our sin. So true commitment is tough. Philippians 2:7. He made Himself nothing by taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness. Sometimes we don't follow through with commitments because we make their completion more difficult than we should. We don't accomplish our commitments because we're either not focused or we've not prioritized them. When we make a commitment, we need to get it done. When we make a commitment, we need to follow through or follow action that needs to take place. So let's not complicate making a commitment. Matthew 5:37. All you need to say is simply yes or no. Anything beyond that comes from the evil one. So when we find ourselves stammering and stuttering, we just need to say, okay, Lord, what is it? Yes or no. And too many times we kind of rationalize or we slip in what we want to slip in. Lord, I have to watch that season on Netflix. I have to cover it because that way I can talk to people about it and I can witness. And God says, "Who angels, who are they talking to? Angels, what are they saying now?" And so don't rationalize either yes or no. Remember, it's all about priorities. It's all about time. It's all about commitment. So the first step in making a commitment is to know what our priorities are. See, everything gets back to what are your priorities? What is important? And in what order are we going to hold them? One thing I love working with Pastor Donna, she is like an energy bunny. An energy bunny rabbit on steroids, on and she's choo-choo-choo-choo-choo-choo. And a lot of times I have to say, okay, you got to eat an elephant. And how do you eat an elephant? One bite at a time. And here's the problem, is we start at the right trunk, our right leg, and then we go to the trunk, and then we go to the left leg, and then we go here. How do you eat an elephant? You eat one leg at a time, one bite at a time. Slow down. You need to get a priority, follow the priority, get it done. And when we have our priorities outlined, it's easy. When we're able to accomplish our commitments that have been established, we're going to have peace. If we have commitments based on out of our priorities, that we're going to find ourselves bouncing back and forth. And that's why don't let someone else make their priorities your priorities. When you put someone else's priorities on you, you're done. Because you won't be able to fulfill your own priorities. Someone else, you're going to be expecting someone else. And if you're trying to do someone else a priority, all you're doing is you're just going to be running. And then you're going to wonder, why am I so tired? Why am I burned out? Why am I this and that? I don't believe in being burned out. A person that's burned out has been a person that does not prioritize. Now, I'm not saying there's not times we're weary. There's not times we get worn down. But you know what? That's when we got to prioritize. That's when we got to be able to tell people no. That's when we got to be able to say, this is what is most important right now. This is what is crucial. Commitment gives us peace. Isaiah 26:3, you will keep in perfect peace those whose minds are steadfast because they trust in you. Notice that their minds are steadfast. I like that. And think of the imagery of that. Stead, you're standing firm, and you're standing fast. You're not going to be moved. And see, here's what happens is Nat says, oh, Pastor, I need you to do this. Blake says, I need you to do this. Chuck says, I need you to do this. And what am I doing? And then pretty soon, oh, I've not done what God wants me to do. And so you say, well, wait a minute. We're to serve others. Yes, we are. By what God wants us to serve them. By how God has it. This is a tough lesson for some of us because some of us are been raised, whenever anyone asks us to do something, we're supposed to do it. That's not healthy. It's not healthy for you. It's not healthy for them. It's not what God wants. Because a lot of times, there are times when people will just keep taking and taking and taking, and you're hurting them. You're not helping them. You're actually hurting them. So you have to prioritize and make commitments. You guys okay out there? This is a tough week. So we're all going to face challenges, John 16:33. In this world, you're going to have problems. Yet even while we're going through hard times, when we have the right priorities, we're pursuing them, we'll be able to know that we know. We'll be able to rest even though it's tough right now. We're affirmed in that God will get us through. We can know that we know. 2 Timothy 1:12, this is why I'm suffering, yet it's no cause for shame, because I know whom I believe, and I'm convinced that he is able to take care and entrust me, trust more to him until that day. And that's what I want you to know, is when we are set our priorities and when we're committed to follow them, not what everyone else wants us to do, but what God wants us to do, we will have a peace. As we make commitments, there will be times when the enemy continually places thoughts and images in our mind. How many times has God said, I want you to do this, but someone else has called and said, I need you to do this? And what do we start doing? We start beating ourselves up. I guess I'm not a good enough Christian. So we go ahead and do what the person wants instead of what God wants us to do. You know, as a pastor, I'll tell you what, if I did everything you church people wanted me to do, I would not sleep. And I'm not trying to be mean. I'm just saying every one of us has needs. But I have needs. And I have priorities under God. And so there's times when I'll have to say no. Or someone will say, can I spend some time with you? But we have to schedule it. Again, it's important to do that, but what is God wanting us to do? Because when we continually just give out, it's just going to eat us up. I know that's hard for some of us, but it's reality. It's reality. And it's scriptural. That's very scriptural. We're to be committed toward moving to God. Philippians 3:13, brothers and sisters, I don't consider myself yet there to have taken hold of it, but one thing I do, forgetting what is behind and straining toward what is ahead. So when we fulfilled our commitment, we can rest assured we've been faithful. When we've aligned our proper priorities with solid commitments, there's a sense of not only relief, but a positive rest. A job done well feels good. So let's make commitments that incorporate. When all is said and done, can we say this? 2 Timothy 4:7, I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. You see, sometimes we get so busy. Yeah, and there's times I find this all the time. I'll tell the Lord, I'm too busy to do this, and then he will arrange it that I wasn't as busy as I was before. And it's please don't ever tell God that you're too busy, because he can change circumstances and situations. So the question I have for you, I want you to get your priorities. What is important to you? And again, you can tell what's important to you by your time. How much time do you spend? That's what's important to you. And then are our commitments. What are you committed to? And a commitment is something that you're following through. So are our commitments aligned with our priorities? So in other words, my family is important to me. And I make a commitment to take care of my family, but I'm not spending time with them. So is that priority and commitment, are they lining up? No. So I need to see what is going, what other commitments, what's taking place of that's getting in the way of my priorities. And what do we need to do to change? What do we need to do to change? And you know, it's amazing. I was just talking to someone the other day that had a little baby, and I said, you know what, they grow up so quick. And I remember when I was when we were parents of little ones, and people said, they grow up so quick. I thought, that's the dumbest thing. They need to come to my house at night when they're screaming at 2 o'clock in the morning and tell me how fast they're growing up. Let me tell you what, they grow up so quick. Mm-hmm. And it's just like that. And I remember holding that baby, and Jonathan wouldn't sleep, so I had to throw him in a car seat and drive around 3, 4 in the morning. Janine said, which one of us is going to do it? I'm like, yeah, we know.
Yeah.
That's your little beautiful eyes, and I'll do it, but I'm really tired. You know, and who's out there at 3, 4 in the morning? You erase that part. And so, you know, it was me. And so I remember I was driving saying, this boy ain't ever going to grow. He ain't ever going to grow. he is going to be like this until he's 23. Well, he's kind of like that now as he's 23. And so I just don't drive him in the car seat anymore. And so it goes so quick. And here's what happens. If we're not conscious of our time, we get so busy that our time will go. And are we accomplishing what God wants? I'm a little heretic. No, I'm a big heretic. I really believe that God wants us to change this world. I do. And I believe it so much. And when you say, well, we're not on Fox News or CNN, that's not the world. The world is a person you come into contact. I believe we are to change people we come into contact. And do we? Do people experience more of God because they've connected with us? Or are they turned away from God? And so when we are a people who have our priorities and our commitment first starting with God, that's when people will see that. People will see that and they will draw close to God. Setting priorities, physical, emotional, spiritual. So we've looked at passage of time. We looked at priorities. Please, at the end of this week, I hope you have your priorities. They're the foundational part and the commitment. What are you committed to? So today we're going to examine how our priorities, and tomorrow we're going to look at I'm going to give you a practical exercise, and it's going to be a tough one. It's going to be a tough one on how we carry out our commitments. Well, first of all, we are not simple, one-dimensional organisms. I mean, we're very, very complex. And we're comprised and made up of three components, our physical, emotional, and spiritual. And our physical is our body, our flesh and blood, muscle and sinew, our internal organs and appendages. Our emotional is our feelings and our desires, our moods, and our state of mind. And our spiritual is our relationship with God. It's our connection with the one who created us. And really, that's what we are created. Scripture says that we're three dimensions. 1 Thessalonians 5:23, may God himself, the God of peace, sanctify you through and through. May your whole spirit, relationship with God, soul, your emotions, and body, your physical, be kept blameless till the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. So we are components. We are made up of our physical, made up of our emotional, made up of our spiritual. It's like a three-legged stool. And if any one leg is chopped off or is not healthy, then the stool will lean over and you're going to fall. And so it's important to understand that we are three-dimensional, we're tri-dimensional. We are created by God as physical beings with an eternal spirit. And God's encased our spirit and our soul in a cocoon of skin and bone. And he not only created us physical, but he knows what physical beings were going to be even before we were born. He knew our physical before we were even born. Psalms 139:13, for you created my innermost being. You knit me together in my mother's womb. And as we age and mature, our physical body is going to age and mature. And our physical part is a unit of makeup. It makes up. It's important for us to set priorities. It's easy to fall into a trap of not taking care of ourselves physically. With so many expectations, many of us don't have the priorities for physical beings. And this is when it's tough for me. It's I struggle with as I'm giving out. It's like, man, I need to go out and take a walk. Ooh, I'm really wore out. And so this is something, though, when we don't take care of our physical, it will affect our emotional, will affect our spiritual. And so our physical being is important to take care of. 1 Corinthians 6:19. Don't you know that your bodies are temples of the Holy Spirit who's in you, whom you received, you're not your own. So our bodies are actually the temple of the Holy Spirit. So this is what I want to encourage you on day 4. What priorities do we have to take care of our physical being for God? What is some priorities for our physical being? What do we need to work on? What are we going to do? So what do we need to work on? Those are the priorities. And then what are we going to do? That's the commitment. Do you see how it's hand in hand? And it's so important, is many times we think of, well, I got to take care of this, or I got to do this, but we don't really think of how are we going to take care of ourselves physically. Physically, how are we going to do what we should do? The second component of our tridimensional is our emotions. And many people say that person made me mad, or that situation made me happy. We've got to understand this. We cannot be made to do anything. You and I have free will. We choose.
In the middle of the night and a baby needs driving around with me.
I was forced to do that. I chose to do that because of my love for my wife. And the baby. More than love for the wife, because I wasn't happy with the
baby.
That's
a preemptive.
Remember, we choose how we respond. We choose our emotions. Please don't say, someone made me mad. No one can make you mad. You choose to be mad. And actually, anger is a secondary emotion. What happens first? Someone says, you're a turkey. And so what happens is, oh, I start to feel inadequate because they would call me a turkey, or I start to feel disrespected. And so the second, that's the first emotion. What happens to the second emotion? I get angry. Oh, I'm a turkey? Well, you're a turkey's uncle. And you know, and so that's what happens is that's when we lash out. So what I encourage you to do, and I'm not saying I'm an expert at, please, you know, we're all journeying, we're all pilgrims sojourning together. But when someone says something to upset you, the first thing you need to do, and we're going to talk about this Sunday a little bit, but the first thing we need to do is we need to say, okay, why is that bothering me? I had someone yesterday doesn't go to the church or isn't involved in church in any way, and they made a comment, and man, that just was like a knife. And the first thing I thought was, well, you know what? I really don't like them anyway. And I thought, well, that's not a good attitude. And I went back and I thought, well, why did they say that? Well, this is a hurting person, and hurting people hurt others. And it hit me, I need to be praying for this person, and I need to look at that was an area that they hid in me that I'm thinking, you know what, they're right, that's why it bothered me. And so instead of continuing to get mad, it's funny, I ran into them today and they said, you know what, I said a little bit too much to you, and I said, you know what, I needed to hear that. And they were like, really? And again, they're like, you are, and this person does not have any church affiliation at all, does not have anything to do with God. And this person said, you know what? She says, I always see God in you. And I thought, you know what? He wasn't really in there yesterday. I was mad yesterday. I was upset yesterday. I was hurt yesterday. I was more hurt. But again, I thought, whoa, okay, what's going on in me? Don't respond. What's going on in me? And so God kind of, and God always is God. And so be careful with your emotions. Your emotions will fail you. You're up on the mountain one day, you're up on the valley, you're down the valley, mountain valley, mountain valley. You go high and low, you're on a roller coaster. And people see that. And if you're 1 minute, hey, how you doing? The next minute, ooh, people are going to say, what kind of God do they have? And I'm not saying that everything's going to be perfect. I'm not saying we're always in the dumps. But remember our emotions. Remember our emotions. So our emotions are crucial, and it can be how our relationship with God is expressed. Proverbs 16:32. Better a patient person than a warrior with one with self-control. Better a patient person than a warrior. One with self-control than one who can take a city. So outward power, outward strength is nothing. It's the person who's able to sit back and say, what's going on? What's happening to me? Emotions aren't bad. Emotions are natural, and God's given characteristics to us. Our emotions can help us draw closer. Our emotions can solidify aspects of our relationship. We can feel peace when we really can't even begin to comprehend. When we have godly sorrow, we can begin to feel the depths of love. So the emotions of Jesus were very powerful. Luke 19:41, as he approached Jerusalem, he saw the city. What did he do? He wept over it. And that was the heart of God. So this is a question I have. And you can tell your emotions. Are you always high and low? Are you always on the extreme? So the question I have, what priorities do we have to take care of our emotional component with God? What are we having to prioritize? What in our life is going on? Is what people are saying and doing around us, is that getting to us? Well, then how can we prioritize for us to draw closer to God? What do we need to work on? Do we get our feelings hurt? If we get our feelings hurt a lot, then we have to ask ourselves, why do we get our feelings hurt? Why? What's going on in me? If we feel that, you know, we're the victim. You know what? I got problems. You got problems. All God's children got problems. And too many times people tell me, well, Pastor, I can't believe this happened to me. I'm thinking, why not? You want to hear my problems? You know, it's interesting. We all have situations. And so what we need to do with emotions, we need to understand, okay, what's going on? How am I responding? And then what are we going to do? Now, I'm not saying, please hear me. I'm not saying we're to be robots. I'm not saying that we're to be emotionless. I mean, when something bad happens, we grieve. We should grieve. But we need to make sure that we are not allowing Satan to play with our emotions. Because Satan plays with our emotions like crazy. I don't feel like going to church today. So what happens? We don't go to church. I don't feel like studying my Bible today. Oh, what happens? We don't study our Bible. And so Satan uses our emotions to beat us up. So the last part is our spiritual dimension. While the other entities are valuable, our spiritual condition determines our eternal destination. And so one beautiful thread woven through our relationship with God is He wants us to know Him. God desires for us to come closer. He really does want a connection with us. So God allows Him to know Him better. This is what's so cool. Matthew 5:6. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. I mean, think about that. The more we want to know of God and learn of God, we're going to be filled. And then you know what happens when you get filled? You want to learn more and more and more. And then when you get filled, you want to learn more and more and more. And it's so incredible because God wants us to know more and more of Him. He wants us to be filled. And we can continue to grow spiritually. This is what I want to encourage you. Too many times, and this happened in the Church of God, we kind of blew it theologically. We blew it theologically by we came to the altar once, got saved, and then we came to the altar twice and got sanctified, and then we stopped. And what we need to understand, sanctification is a continual process of every day being sold out, surrendered to God. Every day. And that's why, you know, it breaks my heart. When I know people who've been saved for 40 years and they act like they've been saved for 40 minutes. Something's wrong. Something's not right. We should be growing spiritually. We should be more stronger spiritually than we were a year ago. And even if we're in the same situation or if we're in worse situations, we still can be spiritually stronger. And so that's what I want to encourage us. 2 Peter 3:18. But grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. To Him be glory both now and forever. Grow in the knowledge and the grace and the knowledge. Are we growing in the Lord? Are we spiritually stronger than we were before? And you can tell that. You know how you can tell that? You can tell that by how you're handling things. You can tell it by how much time you're spending with God. So here we have, what priorities do we need to work on spiritually to grow closer to God? What are some priorities that we need to have? Are they spending more time in the Word? Are they spending more time in prayer? Are they spending more time just being with God? Is it spending more time praising? You know, this is something that it was fascinating as I was driving home from Anderson this weekend. It hit me. I was just worshiping the Lord, and it was almost like He said to me, "We need to do this more often." And I said, "We." Talking about, Lord. We do this all the time. I mean, I'm praying or studying. And He says, no. He said, you know what? It's just you and I just hanging out. And I thought, you know what? A lot of time I'm praying for others or I'm studying or I'm doing that time for others. And you know what God was saying? I just want to hang out with you. I just want you and I just to relax. And it was so cool. And this week I have been intentional where I have taken time and just said, you know what? I'm going to go spend some time with the Lord. And it's amazing. I don't have the time to do it. Well, yeah, you do. You have 168 hours in the week just like I do. And it's incredible. Is I think we get so busy for God that we miss God. So just spend time with God. Take a walk and just look and say, God, I can't believe that tree you made. And just look at that tree. And see the branches and imagine how God took a little bitty seed. And that was in the ground, in dirt. And then it rained and things like that. And then it came up as a seedling, as a sapling, and then it just grew. And then think about all that God has done for us. I mean, think about how God protects you. Think about how God looks out for you. Think of how much beautiful God takes that, which is nothing, and raises it up. And just spend time, just kind of spiritually, just growing with the Lord. Just kind of hang out with Him. You'll enjoy it. You'll enjoy it. So what priorities do we have? What do we need to work on? What are we going to do? So look back over priorities we listed for physical. Remember, I want to encourage you, come up with physical priorities, come up with emotional priorities, come up with spiritual priorities, and some may be very, very, very basic. Some may be very basic, but we may just not be doing them. What will it take not to just know them, but to live them? And then once we know our priorities, make a commitment to follow through and actually live them. Okay. We are going to go very, very practical. May I have you pass these out, please? And I have to apologize to you. I do miss Pastor Donna because she's my tech person. And this should be this way, so it's really, really little. If she was here, it would have been right. So this is an example. When she gets back, she's going to fix this. That's a priority that I have for her. So this should be this way. It should be bigger for you to see. So I apologize it's smaller. I just don't know what I'm doing with a computer. So we're going to look at day 5, making our time count. So we've looked at priorities, and I hope you've been challenged to set them. Because if you don't set priorities, who's going to set priorities for you? Well, nobody and everybody. Yes. Yeah. Nobody will set priorities, but everybody will demand something from you. And so what will happen is you'll remember the Stretch Armstrong? That's what happens to us when other people do our priorities. And so then we make a commitment. And again, if we are not committed to anything, we will fall for everything. So today, we're going to work through a tool. And this is written by a guy named Stephen Covey. He actually passed away. He slipped on ice and conked his head. But he wrote a great book. If you've not read this book, read this book. It's called 7 Habits of Highly Effective People. Excellent, phenomenal book. This is right on. And the first question that we do is we have to ask, this kind of helps with priorities and commitment. What roles do we have? All of us have multiple roles. And priorities can fall through the crack because we don't realize what roles. So a role could be a husband, father, son, worker, neighbor, colleague, whatever. But if we don't know the many roles, it's easy to be overwhelmed. The most important role under God is our family. 1 Timothy 5:8, anyone who doesn't provide for their relatives, and especially for their own household, has denied the faith and is worse than an unbeliever. That's a powerful verse. That's a powerful verse. And so what roles do you have? What are some of the roles you have? Just name them.
Mom.
What else?
Cook.
Wife.
Cook.
Cook.
Grand.
Grandmother. Sure.
Babysitter.
Yeah. And here's the thing is, I don't think we realize how many roles we have. And what happened, and I encourage you to write down what roles. Now, if you have 150 roles, you got to cut back. You need to cut something quick. If you, not belly rolls. If you've got 150.
That too.
If you've got 150 roles, you're doing too much. Because if you've got 150 roles, what does that mean you're doing? What are you doing well?
None.
Nothing. And you, that's when you will get burnt out. And I'll tell you, when you prioritize and make commitments, you will not burn out. You won't. It's when we get so many things going on. And that's why we get stressed. Now, I'm not saying there's not situations. I mean, there's times in the ministry where we'll have, 8,000 things going on. But you know what you do then? You just take a deep breath and you charge ahead. And God gets you through that season. And then afterwards, slow down. Take a Sabbath, stop, and then get re-energized by God. But when you have so many roles, and here's the thing, is most people don't realize what roles they have. So write out your roles. Now, with each of these roles, you should have a goal. And you can see on the paper, and again, this should be flipped over so you can see more. But under each of the roles, you should have a goal. And if one of our roles is a parent, then what are we hoping to accomplish? Do we want our kids to grow up respectful? Do we want our kids to know God? Do we want our kids to help determine our priorities? What's a goal? If it's a mother, what is your goal? If it's a grandmother, what's your goal as a grandmother? If it's a husband, if it's a wife, if it's son or daughter, what are your goals? What is the end result that you want, that all said and done, this is what my role wants to accomplish? And once goals have been established, then you can see priorities. Proverbs 21:5, the plans of the diligent lead to profit, as surely as haste leads to poverty. If we don't have goals, then how are we going to know we've accomplished what we're supposed to? And so then with each role we listed, list your goals. Each role you have, what are your goals? Like I said, if you have 150 roles, you got too many. You need to start making some priorities. You need to start saying no. Because if you say yes to everything, you're saying no to everything. And so look at your roles and what are your goals of your roles? And if one of your goals is because I want to help this person or because this person needs me, you know what? You are not God. Here's the thing I learned about in the ministry a long time ago as an older minister once told me, he said, son, he said, you don't have to die for the church. He said, Jesus already did that. Don't let them kill you. Because if they kill you, they're killing them. And that's so powerful, is if we do not set priorities, we're not any good. We're going to hurt those around us. So with each role, what is your goal? Now, it's not just enough to know your roles, but to come up with goals, we must have specific, deliberate, intentional plans. Priorities are necessary, but if we're not doing anything, we're just spinning our wheels. Many people have plans, but they don't carry them out. One of the first steps to being successful for a plan is to write it down. Something powerful happens when you write. You say, I know my hands are cramped up. Something powerful happens. You memorize it. There's a person working through one step closer, and they're down, they're behind a little bit, but they said, I'm not going to quit, Pastor, and it's, but I want you to know, I've learned more going through this than I ever have before, and I said, keep doing it. There's something powerful about writing. Habakkuk 2:2, the Lord replied, write down the revelation and make it plain on tablets so a herald may run with it. When you write something down, something powerful happens. Matter of fact, Harvard did a study, and they found that 3 out of every 5 people who wrote out their daily goals, 3 out of those 5 people were very successful. And the reason is because what are they doing every day? They're writing their what are they what's important? What's their priority? What should they be doing? And they're reinforcing it. And then when they're not accomplishing it, and it's easy to say no. Someone says, hey, I need you to come and do this. You can say, you know what? That's taking away from what God wants me to do. So write it down. So go back. You look over your roles. You look over your goals. And then you look through this week, Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, Sunday. And you look through and you prioritize. So, okay. So here's my role. My role is a father. My goal is to spend time with my kids. So what is on Sunday? So Sunday means instead of, even though I love doing it, and it's the 11th commandment, instead of I love watching golf and falling asleep for 3 hours on Sunday afternoon, it's just in the Bible. It's in Leviticus somewhere. And so maybe I take an hour and a half nap, and maybe I go and spend an hour with one of the kids. Or maybe in some doing something else on Monday, what I'll do is I'll go out, take one of the kids out to breakfast. So what you're doing is you got your role, you got your goal. If your goal is to spend more time with your kids, as father, for example, and then what are you going to do on Sunday? What are you going to do on Monday? What are you going to do on Tuesday? So what you're doing is you're starting to list priorities. And so write down what specific plans. Now important, now this is crucial. An important facet of priorities is to take care of yourself. You remember Mark 10:16, it says, you're to love your neighbor as you love yourself. We've always misinterpreted that. We've always said that means we have to do for others. That's not what that says. It says if you don't love you, you can't love anyone else. If you're not taking care of you, you can't take care of anyone else. Well, Pastor, other people need me. Not always. Other people will use us. Other people will take from us, and we may be hurting them. We may be hurting them instead of helping them by us continually giving to them. So there's times when we have to say, hey, you know what? I can't. Well, you've got to take care of yourself. And so what he has is he calls this sharpening the sword, the saw, and the promise keepers I heard, output without input equals cuphood. And that's where burnout happens. If you're burned out, you know what you're doing? You're doing much more than you're taking in. You're giving more than you're receiving. And what I believe burnout is I believe is we are not receiving from God, but we're just giving out.
You get to a point where you got all these to do and you don't know where to start, so you just do nothing.
And that can happen too. And that's why what you have to do is you have to write down your roles. And because that's easy for people to get so overwhelmed. What do? They sit there and watch 8 hours of TV. And again, it's so easy. Your time will be filled up. But really, is it filled up with what God wants us to do? So write out your goal, your roles. Write out a goal for that. And then write out a day. Write out what you're going to do. Prioritize. But this is important. Is take care of yourself. Exodus 20:10, it says the seventh day is a Sabbath. You're not to do any work, neither you, your son, your daughter, your male, your female servant, not your animals, your foreigner. You know what they were supposed to do on the Sabbath?
Rest.
Now we, especially as Christians, Sunday is the busiest day we have. And then Monday we go back to work. And Saturday we're doing everything in house. What is our Sabbath? What day are we truly saying, Lord, this is your day when I'm going to rest? And so we need to build that in. Now, I personally believe that we build in little Sabbaths. And that's important, is we can build in little Sabbaths during the week. But if you don't have a Sabbath, if you don't have a rest, you're going to go kaput. So what are you going to do to take care of yourselves in these areas? Physically. What are you going to do physically to take care of yourself? What are you going to do mental to take care of yourself? What are you going to do spiritually? And then what are you going to do socially or emotionally? And so what this does is this makes you think, I've got to do something just for me. I've got to do something that is sharpening my saw. Because what happens if we're cutting down a tree, and what happens if we don't quit and sharpen the saw? What will happen?
You don't saw as fast,
and eventually we'll break the saw. So you remember the old story, the two guys racing. One was an old farmer, one was a young buck, and the young buck kept hacking away at the tree, and the farmer, he would saw for about 10 minutes, then he'd stop and sharpen it and saw. Who got it done? Who got felled the tree quicker? The farmer did, who sharpened the saw, because he did more work. Some of us are working so hard, we need to work smart. That's why it amazes me in church, sometimes in churches, and folks, sometimes we kind of tip into this at Ash Avenue. Sometimes we get so busy that we are all wore out. And so I'm not saying we shouldn't be doing ministry. I'm not saying we shouldn't do things. But when we're wore out, what good are we to the kingdom? Because something somewhere has got to give, doesn't it? And so sharpen your saw. Okay. So now you've got an example. And again, this is just an example. I'm sorry, it's so small. It should be flipped over. I will get you some copies of it flipped over when Pastor Donna gets back. And so anyway, but then this is what I want to encourage you to do. For a week, keep track of your time.
Can we choose the week?
Can I get a secretary?
Do this week. For a week, take care of your time. Because this is what you're going to find, is you are going to find that at the end of this week, you know what you're going to do? You're going to say, oh my goodness, boy, I spent a whole lot of time on Thursday doing nothing, and that's why I'm feeling so pressured on Friday. Remember, sharpen the saw.
That's my Sabbath.
Well, if it's your Sabbath, good. If that's your Sabbath, yeah, don't Sabbath every day.
Yeah.
You do got to work 6 days. And that's it. Remember, we rationalize and we justify. That's funny, kind of. But I encourage you, keep track of your time. You will be blown away. You will be very, very surprised. I believe that one reason that God moved us from Bell Fountain, I was working 100 to 110 hours a week at the church. Church was growing. We were a very large congregation. I was one of the top, I don't want to say top, I was one of the most public ministers in the community. If there was an event, if there was a chamber of commerce thing, if there was a board meeting, I was there. And you know what? I look back on that time, And I was missing the joy. And I have the joy of ministry and the joy of the Lord back. But you know what I tend to do is I've been watching, because I keep very, very track of my hours, and I'm creeping back. And that's just kind of who I am, but it's not right. And so what God is saying is, you know what, buddy? I taught you a lesson and you learned it. Don't forget it. And so that's important. So I want to encourage you. What does your week look like? What is your week doing? And once you go through, sit down and say, whoo. And then what are your priorities? If your priorities are to be a good husband, wife, mother, father, but then you look through your week and you spend a half hour with your kids or a half hour with your mom and dad, what does that say? You guys okay? You're looking at me like I'm a dentist. I know. Okay. I encourage you to do this. This is going to be a tough week for some of you.
Not as tough as that other one.
Which amazes me, but that's all right. This is going to be a tough week, but I want to encourage you again. Remember, we only grow when we realize where we're at. And that's why a lot of times there's been people who've been saved for a long time, but they're very spiritually immature, because they've never looked at where they're at. Or they've rationalized. Well, I could get upset about this because, well, wait a second. You've been saved 10 years. You should not get upset about that. And so what we need to do is we need to take a hard look. Spiritual growth is not easy. It's work. And we can, this, our calendar will tell us what's important to us. Our calendar will tell us. And so I encourage you to really, really use this. Use this week. And then we'll get back next week. We'll touch base on this. And if you want to get more copies, we'll get you more copies. But I encourage you to take a hard look and set your priorities and your commitments. All right. Closing comments, questions.
Starting now. You said we had to do it for a week. We don't have to do it for a week. We have to start right now and be done by now.
Helen, you have too many roles.
Hey,
slow down. Your role is not to take care of me. Janine does that. Slow down. And what we do is we do have, when we have, if you have 150 roles, you better cut it in half, because it'll kill you.
Oh, you're allowed to have 75.
If you have 75, take a hard look at 75. If you have more than 15, take a hard look at that. All right. Well, I'm going to pray for y'all, and I am going to give you a priority. And that priority is, after I pray for y'all, is to go to someone and say, I don't know what this guy's talking about, but I love the Lord. So go and love on someone. That's a priority I want to give you. So please rise with me. I'm going to pray for you. Boy, I kept you guys so long. That's what happens when I don't teach for 3 weeks. Woo! I'm gonna go ahead and bless you all, and then I want to encourage you, go bless someone else. Father, thank you for this day. Lord, this is a tough week. It's a tough week because we have to look at where we're at and what's our priorities and what's our commitment. And Lord, most important thing is we want to be committed to you. Most important thing is where we're at with you in our life. So let us take a good and a hard look. And Lord, it's not always to beat us up. It's not to beat us up. It's not to make us feel bad. It's not to make us do more. It's for us to grow closer to you. That's why we're doing what we're doing, is to know you better, to know you more, to step closer to that connection with you. And so, Father, bless my brothers and sisters. Don't make this a hardship. Just make it a time when it's realizing where we're at and where we need to be and where we're going. And so I bring my brothers and sisters to you. I bring them to you in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen.